Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, I'm going to start with chapter 16 of my Stochastic Modeling book. That's the chapter about the Waller model. So I already introduced the Waller model in a previous video. We saw the definition. We also saw how we can write the local transition rights of the process and even how we can construct the process using a graphical representation. So before we get started, I quickly remind you the definition. I remind you that in the Waller model, each site of the integer lattice in D dimension is occupied by exactly one individual. Those individuals can be of type 0 or of type 1. In particular, we are dealing with a competition model where two different types are going to compete for space. And the process evolves by assuming that all those individuals independently give birth to an offspring of their own type at right one. And at birth, the offspring is sent to one of the 2D nearest neighbor of the parent site chosen uniformly at random. And this offspring is going to replace the individual at the target site. So in the previous video, I studied the contact process, and for the contact process, we saw that we had one or even two phase transitions, depending on the graph where the process evolves. So more precisely, we saw that we have a phase of extension and a phase of survival for the process on integer lattices. Now, if we look at the process on regular graphs, on regular trees, then we have two-phase transition and with an intermediate phase of weak survival. So, in particular, the behavior of the contact process strongly depends on the birth parameters, but it turns out that the behavior of the process does not really depend on the spatial dimension or the degree of the tree where the contact process evolves. In contrast, for the Waller model, we don't have any parameter. We just assume that all the individuals give birth at right one, so there is no parameter that would dictate how the process evolves. But still, it turns out that we have again phase transition for the Waller model, but this time the critical value will be the spatial dimension. And so by that, I mean that we will see in the next videos that in fact the behavior of the process, the behavior of the Waller model qualitatively strongly depend on the spatial dimension, and we have one type of behavior in one dimension, another type in two dimension, another type in higher dimension, three or above, and so on. And so now, regardless of the aspect of the Waller model you want to study, always the key to study the Waller model, the starting point of any result about the Waller model, is duality. So we saw this technique for the contact process, and here the idea is kind of the same. The idea is to start by defining this notion of path, and then dual process. Then from that we can derive some kind of duality relationship that shows a connection between the model itself, like the Waller model itself, and its dual process. And it's also, of course, important to understand the structure of the dual process. So that's what I'm going to do in this video. We are going to define all this. And if you remember the way we proceed for the contact process, the first step was really to fix a graphical representation. And then we can define all these notions from realization of the graphical representation. So to do this, I'm going to start by saying that we fix a graphical representation of the representation of the Waller model. So I defined this object in a previous video. So here, instead of having birth and death, like for the contact process, we only have birth, but at each birth, there is also death of the individual at the target site. And the way you construct this process is just by having independent Poisson processes at each site. along each edges, along each oriented edges, those Poisson processes have right 1 divided by 2D, and at the times of those processes, we draw an arrow, okay, and that corresponds to a birth-death event. So birth of an offspring going from the tail of the arrow to the tip of the arrow, but then the individual at the tip of the arrow die. So that means that the graphical representation of the contact process looks like that in one dimension. So you have those lines like this, and let's say that maybe we have an arrow like this, and an arrow like that, and one like this, and so on. So, and the interpretation again is that like here you have two individuals of possibly two different types, and at this time this individual is going to give birth here and replace the individual that was here. So that's how we can construct the process graphically. And so now that we have this graphical representation, we can, exactly like we did for the contact process, in order to define the dual process and duality techniques in general, duality relationship and so on, the first step is to define the notion of path. So that's going to be similar to what we did for the contact process, except that of course the definition of path is going to be slightly different. But eventually that's going to be useful to understand the process. So first step, let's define the notion of a path going from a space-time point that I'm going to again call zt minus s to xt. So I'm going to draw an arrow up like that to say that we have a path, because a path are going to move forward in the graphical representation. So here, you remember that for the contact process, we wanted to have some kind of definition that would tell us whether XT is occupied or not, whether site X is occupied or not at time T. And so the definition of path for the contact process was such that this site is occupied whenever this site is occupied. This space-time point is occupied whenever this space-time point is occupied. Here, instead of keeping track of whether sites are occupied or not, we are keeping track of whether sites are of type 0 or of type 1. So, to have a good definition of this notion of path that is going to be useful after, what we want to have is some definition such that the type of this space-time point is going to be the same as the type of this space-time point. And so the idea to do this is really like in the contact process, to follow the arrows along their direction, in their direction. But now we don't have death marks anymore, but the tip of arrows play the role of death marks. So eventually, we don't have death marks that can block the path, but the tips of the arrows are going to block the path. So we are going to define this notion of path by saying that we can go from this one to this one, given a graphical representation. If in this graphical representation, we can go from this point to this point, going forward in time, so going up, but in such a way that the path, you know, by crossing the arrows, but by avoiding the tip of the arrows. Okay? So, let me show you a picture so that you understand this better. So, here I'm showing you a graphical representation of the Voler model. So, you see, we have only arrows now. The arrows start from each vertex, from each site at right one, at the times of a Poisson process with intensity one. Here, I'm taking two yellow points. So we have a point 2t at the top of the picture. We have another yellow point at site 0 at the bottom of the picture. Now the question is there a path from the yellow point at the bottom to the yellow point at the top? Well, yes, because we can indeed go from the one point to the other one by crossing, not only crossing the arrows, but also avoiding the tip of the tip of the arrows. So this picture shows you what we mean by a path, okay? So there is, of course, a much more rigorous definition you can give using the arrival time of the Poisson processes and so on, but the definition is pretty long and messy, and that doesn't give much. It's better just to have this picture in mind. So then next step, over definition, it's again this notion of dual path. Now dual paths are going to move backward in time, exactly like for the contact process. And a dual path is exactly, we said that there is a dual path from A to B if there is a path from B to A. Okay, so I'm going to say that this a path like that is exactly the same as a dual path going from XT to ZT minus S. Now I'm going to write an arrow going down, because we go down in the graphical representation to draw this path, and we move backward in time. So we have this and ZT minus S. Okay, so this is a definition of a dual path, and then from that again, we can define the notion of dual process. And so that's another definition. And now the dual process is kind of defined exactly like for the contact process, with one little exception, because in the contact process, we are interested in whether a given site is, whether a site is occupied or not. While for the contact, for the volar model, what's relevant is really whether set of sites are, like, whether several sites are correlated or not, whether those sites have the same type or not. I'm going to instead define the dual process, not starting from one specific space-time point XT, but from a set at a given time T. Okay, so that's just a little difference. You can also define the dual process starting from XT, but in general, let's define the dual process starting from a finite set A at time T, and then we go down, and basically what we are going to do is just keep track of all the dual paths that go down the graphical representation starting from this set A, okay? So I'm going to write, so definition of the dual process of the volar model. So starting at, so I'm going to write capital A T. So T is a time, and A is going to be a subset of ZD. Typically, we assume that A is a finite subset. And so this process is going to be xi hat s a t. So I'm using the same notation as for the contact process. I'm putting a hat here to differentiate from the volar model itself. Remember that s, that's the same as this time s here, that's what we call the dual time. That's the amount of time we moved backward in time starting from T, okay? So at dual time S, we are at actual time T minus S. And so this dual process is just going to be equal to, so the set of Y in ZD again, such that there is, so I'm going to use Z instead to have the same notation as here. So Z, such that we have a dual path like that. So Z such that there is a dual path XT going down to ZT minus S. So that's the way we define the dual process, but with another definition of dual path, of course, but that's the way we define the dual process for the contact process. Now, you see that for the contact process, that was the dual process starting from XT. Well, here we start from a set, and so what is this X here? That doesn't make any sense. Well, that's the set of Z such that there is a dual path, such a dual path for some X in A, Okay, that's how we complete the definition. So we have this for some X in a set A. So now to have a picture of what happens here, let's go back to this picture of the graphical representation with our path. And now I'm going to draw in yellow again the dual process starting with all 9 vertices at the top of the picture, and we go down, and so eventually the picture you get is exactly this one. So that means that from the top of the picture you go down the graphical representation and just follow all the possible dual paths that gives you this picture, and so eventually this picture you get in yellow, that's some kind of realization in space, like in time of the dual process. And again, to really see the value of the dual process at a given time S, dual time S, what you would have to do in the picture is, let's say, draw a horizontal line at time T minus S, and look at where this horizontal line intersects the yellow region, and the set of vertices you get there, it's going to be exactly the value of the dual process at dual time S. So now that we are done with the definition, the formal definition of the dual process of the variable model, the next step, exactly like for the contact process, is to see why is it useful, and in fact to derive what we call a duality relationship that will connect the dual process and the variable model itself, and see in fact how we can extract useful information from the dual process to understand better the variable model. So next step is to find something that we call again a duality relationship. And so for that, I'm going to start like drawing a little picture with graphical representation of the process, and see what's the interpretation of the dual process. And this time I'm just going to look at the dual process starting from one side. We are only going to look at the dual process starting from one side, XT, so we assume that this set A is reduced to one side, and the goal is to try to understand what's going on here. So, and it might be useful also to show you some kind of comparison and parallel with the contact process. So let me redo a kind of picture of the dual process for the contact process. So let's assume that we have an arrow like that, and another one like this, and maybe a cross here, and here. So here, what I'm doing is not a graphical representation of the variable model. Okay, we have those crosses. That's a graphical representation of the contact process. And so we saw that the contact process starting from a space-time point XT here can be constructed by, well, it's like you inject a fluid here, and the fluid is going to flow down the graph, and it's going to be stuck by those crosses. And also, the fluid is going to cross the arrows in the opposite upper direction. And so that means that here it's going to flow here, being stuck here, and go here. And the interpretation was, well, this site is going to be occupied at time t, okay? This site here is occupied if and only if at time zero is at the bottom, this site is initially occupied. So now, what happens for instead the variable model? So let's draw a similar picture, but now we don't have those crosses anymore. And so let's do, I don't know, something like this, and another arrow like that, and another one like this. So in this case, let's try to understand the dual process of the variable model starting from only this side. So we said that path cannot cross the tip of an arrow. because the tip of an arrow corresponds to a death, okay? And the offspring comes from the tail of the arrow. So what happens in the contact process is that you have birth at some times and death at other times, while in the Wöhler model, the birth and the death occurs at the same time. Each time you have a birth, each birth in fact involves implicitly a death at the target site. And so that means that now the dual process starting from this point is again going to go down like that. But now this tip of an arrow plays the same role as a cross for the contact process, and so you cannot go through here. But the path is going to still cross the arrow in the opposite of its direction, and so on. And so eventually you obtain something that looks like this. So in particular, you see that for the contact process, what we have is a branching event, something that I want to call a branching event that corresponds to adding a site to the dual process. Each time you have an arrow, each time you have a birth, but you also have a death event that corresponds to removing a site from the dual process of the contact process each time you have a cross. So that means that the dual process of the contact process is something, it's some kind of random tree that can grow or but that can also die out. Okay? At the opposite, if you look at the Wöhler model, each time you are stuck, you also jump to another site. So that means that the dual process of the Wöhler model starting from one single site corresponds to just one single dual path. Okay? You don't have branching events, but you don't have death events either. You have instead jumps. Okay? So that's what the dual process of the Wöhler model starting from one point looks like. Now, what is the interpretation of this? Well, again, meaning that we have a dual path going that way, that means also that there is a path if you go forward. And clearly, we define this notion of path in such a way that the type of this individual is going to be the same as the type of this individual. So, that, and indeed, you can check this, no matter the type of this individual, let's assume that it's of type 1. What's going to happen is that up to this point you have type 1, and in fact up to even that point until the tip of this arrow you are sure to have a type 1. Then what happens at this time is that regardless of the state of the, regardless of the type of the individual here, this individual is going to be replaced by the offspring of this individual which is of type 1. And then this type 1 is going to survive up to here, and then gives birth again here and up to here. So indeed, no matter what is the type of the individual here, this individual is going to transmit his type to this individual here at the top. So that means in fact that going backward in time, okay, and following one dual path, what you are doing, in fact, is really keeping track of the ancestor, of the individual at this site. That's how you have to really think of the dual process of the Wöhler model. That's the process that keeps track of the ancestors of a set of sites. So in this case, you can think of, so you have the individual here is the same as here. Here, you jump to the location of the parent, and here you jump to the location of the grandparent of the set. And so, based on this interpretation, you can say that the type, I mean, if I cut the picture at any time, so let's take it like this, and I call this time T minus S, but this T minus S corresponds to dual time S. So what you read here is the value of the dual process at dual time S. Then from that, we can deduce the duality relationship that tells you that the type of site X at time T, so that's going to be CTX, should be equal to the type, of course, of its ancestors. And so in particular, if you look at this time, that's going to be equal to the type at time t minus s. So it's ct minus s of the dual, the single site in the dual process at time, at dual time s, that c hat s of xt. So c hat s of xt. So this is our duality relationship now, okay? For the contact process, the duality relationship, like the connection between the dual process and the contact process itself, was that this site is occupied if you cut here, one of those two sites is occupied, let's say. While for the Wöhler model, now the new duality relationship says that the type of this individual is the same as the type of the individual here. So now that shows why this is useful. So now let's take a look at the picture to understand that. I'm going back to the picture. Here we have again a picture of the dual process that I already showed you. Notice that if you look at the two sites on the extreme left, then, and you follow their like dual path, in fact you follow their ancestor, you see that at some point those two paths coalesce. And in fact, the two dual paths starting from those two sites on at the extreme left, like negative 4 and negative 3, those two paths land at the same site, which is negative 1. And so the interpretation of this feature, what you can deduce from this feature, is that no matter what is the initial configuration, the type of the two individuals at the top left of the picture are going to be identical. Why? Well, because they have the same ancestor and their type is going to be the same type as the individual at site negative 1 at time 0. Same story for the two sites on the extreme right of the picture. If you follow the dual path starting from the top right of the picture, you see that those two paths, they coalesce, eventually they land on the same site, which is 1. So that means that the two sites at the top of the picture are going to be of the same type, and their type is going to be the same as the type of the individual at site 1 at time 0. And if you look at all the sites in the middle, so you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of them, you see again that all the paths starting from those 5 sites in the middle, they all coalesce, they eventually, the 5 dual paths are going to land on the same site 0, so that means that the 5 sites in the middle are of the same type, and the type is going to be defined by the type of individual at site 0 at time 0. And so indeed, if you reproduce again this graphical representation, so on the right here of the slide, I just redrew the exact same graphical representation, and you just fix any, like at random, just some initial configuration, and you want to construct the dual process from that, you obtain that picture. And so again, this picture is obtained by injecting a fluid, let's say like this yellow color, at sites that, let's say, are occupied initially by an individual of type 1. And all this yellow region is going to show you the space-time region occupied by a type 1. And you cross the arrows, but you are stuck with the tip of an arrow. So you obtain this picture and you see that indeed, if you look at this, realization here, you see that indeed the two sites at the top left are identical, they are of type 1. The two sites at the top right are also identical, they are of type 1. And the five sites in the middle are also identical, they are of type 0. So the types could be different, but no matter how you choose the initial configuration, what the dual process on the left tells you is that on the right, you should see that the top two, the two sites at the top left must be of the same type. The two sites on the top right must be of the same type, and the five sites in between must be of the same type. So now, last step of this video, now that we clearly, that we have the definition of the dual process and we understand the connection now between the Wöhler model and its dual process. Basically, the dual process keeps track of the ancestors of a set of individuals. The last step is going to be to understand the dual process from a mathematical point of view, so meaning which kind of object this thing is. How does this evolve as a stochastic process? And so that will tell us that there is basically a duality relationship between the Wöhler model and whatever that is. Okay, so for that, let's go back to this picture. And you see that if you look at the dual process starting from one point only, so A is reduced to a singleton, what you do is you go down the graphical representation and you are going to jump each time you see the tip of an arrow. So now, at which height do you meet? I mean, how long do you need to wait until you meet the tip of an arrow? Well, that's exactly exponential with parameter one, because those arrows, they like the set of arrows that point at one given site appear at right one at the times of a Poisson process with parameter one. So that means that your dual path here, if you look at only one dual path, this dual path is going to jump at right one. Now, obviously, because at each birth, the target site where the offspring is sent is chosen uniformly at random from the 2D neighbors. That means that each time you meet the tip of an arrow, this arrow is equally likely to come from any of the 2D direction. So that means that not only your dual path is going to jump at right one, but also it's going to jump in each of the 2D possible direction with equal probability. So what is this object? Okay, you have just, let's say, a particle here, and the particle is going to jump at right one to any of the 2D possible direction. That's exactly a random walk. So we studied already random walk. We studied random walk in discrete time. This one is the exact same object, except that this random walk is going to evolve in continuous time and is going to jump at right one. But in spirit, that's exactly the same as what we studied earlier, like in previous videos, that's the symmetric random walk. So that explains the structure of this object, the dual process, if you start from one space-time point. Now, what happens when you start with multiple space-time points? So that means that A is a finite subset of ZD with more than one site. So in this case, it turns out that because Poisson processes at different sites are independent, that means that the dual path in this picture are going to evolve according to independent symmetric random walk, except that when two dual paths meet, they coalesce. They are going to get stuck together and they continue evolving together. And well, it makes sense because after they are constructed from the same set of arrows. So eventually, the picture we get is exactly the one of, I mean, from like this little picture and so on, we can deduce that the dual process starting from AT is going to consist, like this set is going to consist of what we call a system of coalescing random walks. So I'm going to write that, that's kind of another important result. So, theorem. I mean, I'm not even going to write theorem because that's kind of obvious, but so conclusion of our pictures and so on is the fact that the dual process of the Wöhler model, so is a system of coalescing random walks. So here I didn't precise, but a system of coalescing random walks that are symmetric and that evolve in continuous time, and all those random walks jump at right one. So now the conclusion is really to have in mind, and that's basically the starting point of any result you want to prove about the Wöhler model, that's to have in mind that the dual process keeps track of the ancestors of the sites at in this set A. So by looking at this, you kind of keep track of the ancestors, which means that because all the offspring are of the same type as the parents, this means that you have this duality relationship. The value, I mean the state or the color of the individual, the type of the individual at earlier time tells you about the type at later time if you go down the dual process. And so that's the first important conclusion. And the other important thing is the fact that the dual process is the system of coalescing random walks. So meaning that the dual process starting from the set AT, from this space-time region AT, is exactly going to, I mean, to construct that, what you do is you put one particle at each site in A. You assume that those particles evolve according to independent symmetric random walk, except that each time two of those random walk intersect, then they are going to coalesce. And then you lose one site in your dual process.